listen and be blessed.
In addition to all of this, message, you need the Holy Ghost and power to be able to make a difference in your life. That's how you walk in the anointing. How do you receive the anointing? It's simple. Very simple. Very simple. Number one is to ask. You say, ask, you will receive. Seek, you will find. Knock, and the door shall be opened unto you. He said, for whoever asketh, receiveth. Whoever seeketh, findeth. And whoever knocketh, the door shall be opened unto him. I'm telling you, many times, the reason people struggle in life is because they deploy their energy in the wrong direction. Some people have tried for 5 years succeeding. They've never asked God to help them. If you ask them, they say, Onitsha is hard. If you ask them, they say, people hate me. And so they have been struggling for 7 years. They have been struggling for 10 years. When was the last time you asked? He said, will a child ask the father for bread and he will give him a serpent? He said, will he ask him for fish? No, for fish, he will give him a serpent, or for bread and he will give him a stone. He said, you too, if you ask the father, he will give you the spirit. The problem is that most of us have not asked for the anointing. We have been laboring with our abilities. And God is just standing there saying, oh, how I wish you asked me. How I wish you asked me. Did you read the story of the prodigal son? The prodigal son took his inheritance, went and wasted it. And when he was done wasting it, he came back. Because he knows there is something about the father that when you ask, he cannot but give. Meanwhile, the other righteous son was at home laboring, hoping that when he labor, one day the father will see him and say, take. Unfortunately, the father only responds to asking. And when the prodigal son came back, the father ran, gave him a signet ring, covered him up, and restored him. And the elder brother became angry. I have been here laboring all day. You have never given me a calf to slaughter with my friend. And the father said, all that I have always been yours, but you have never asked. You have never asked. So the prodigal son was not prodigal in asking. He was prodigal in spending. There was nothing wrong with asking. The problem was with the spending. The elder brother was at home, but he never asked. Could it be that you have been struggling because you've never asked? Could it be that you have been going through that quagmire because you've never asked? Most of the men who make impact in life, they are good at asking because they know that God is their sufficiency. That's why when Jesus began to teach us how to pray, he brought an insight and a consciousness to us that know that where you are asking from, it doesn't finish. That's why I said, our Father who art in heaven, the resources God is giving you is from heaven. It doesn't finish. Don't ask God today and say, no, I have asked too much. There is no such thing as asking too much with God. In fact, you can never ask enough because his name is God El Shaddai. El Shaddai means the multi-breasted one. He never finishes. So God enjoys it when you ask him. Because when you ask him, it's a testimony that your trust is not in your ability. Your trust is in him. You want to walk in the anointing, you must ask. That's why it says to come boldly before the throne of grace and obtain. The word is to take mercy. You will need it for the time of help. You will need it. But many people have not asked. Many people have not obtained. So they struggle. The foundation of human struggle is his inability or lack of understanding to ask. When you are going for your business, ask. When you are going to school, ask. When you are going to ministry, ask. You will need it all your life. It's one of the secrets of overcomers. They know how to ask. You want to walk in the anointing, you must ask for the anointing. Number two, you want to walk in the anointing, you must be born again. He said in John chapter 7, from verse 38, he said, as many as believe, out of their bellies shall flow rivers of living waters. And he said he was speaking of the spirit who had not yet been given because Jesus has not yet been glorified. Now Jesus has been glorified. The Holy Spirit has been given. How come you still don't have? Because you have not accepted Jesus as the Lord of your life. How do you accept Jesus as the Lord of your life? Romans chapter 10 verse 9 and 10. If you believe in your heart the Lord Jesus and confess with your mouth, you will be saved. With the heart man believes unto righteousness, with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. All you need to do is to believe that Jesus is the Son of God and to decree that you are Jesus's property. The moment you say you are Jesus's property, he invests the Holy Spirit on your life. You want to walk in the anointing? You must receive Jesus as the Lord of your life. You want to walk in the anointing? You must consistently ask him for more. Let no day pass in your life when you are in drought. If you are in drought, you will have crisis, because there are too many problems in life for your brain to be able to solve. You have not walked through life enough. That's why you depend so much on your brain. When you walk through life, after a while, you will discover that your brain is grossly insufficient. It takes the ancient spirit that created all things to address the affairs of your life. That's how you receive the anointing. But you see, spiritual things are funny. It's one thing to receive, and it's another thing to walk in it. Receiving and walking in are two different things. He said, you say you are in the spirit. If you are in the spirit, then walk in the spirit. Most of us have received the anointing, but we are not yet walking in it. My major teaching tonight is to show you four basic steps of walking in the anointing. Some of you have received Jesus Christ, and as I'm talking, you say, but I'm born again. Why am I not seeing the anointing? Some of you say, but I've asked for the anointing. Why am I not seeing it? Because it's one thing to receive. It's another thing to walk in. You may have received it, but you may not be walking in it. Hope you know. Someone can give you an inheritance, and it will be in the bank, but you may not withdraw it all your life. Even though you are rich, you may die of hunger. This church has been built. The key has been handed. Hope you know, mama can choose not to come into the church, and the church will be locked down for a while. Is mama, does mama doesn't have a church? She has a church. But whether she walks in it is another, is a different ballgame altogether. Most people are highly anointed, but they don't know how to walk in the anointing. So they are waiting for an apostle to lay hands on them again. They are waiting for a prophet to decree over them. The anointing you already have in your life, you'll be shocked that it's more than enough to change your story. The problem is that you have not begun to walk in the anointing. Three steps for walking in the anointing. Number one is to sustain a consciousness. That's why I'm telling you tonight that when you have the Holy Spirit, when you have Jesus Christ and you have asked for the Holy Spirit, you already have him. You don't need to fall down to have the anointing. You don't need to feel something to have the anointing. The Bible said in 2 Corinthians 5, 7, it said we walk by faith, not by feelings. It's not your feelings that prove that you have it. What proves that you have it is your faith in God when you asked. And when you asked in faith, God will give it to you. Now that God has given him to you, you now need to begin to consciously walk in it. And the first way to walk in it is to have the consciousness. If you don't have the consciousness, the anointing in your life cannot be activated. When I'm going somewhere, sometimes I don't even know what to say. But I tell myself, I have an excellent spirit. There's an anointing on my life. When I get there, the moment I stand, what to say will come. Sometimes I'm going out, and then I know that I'm insufficient. And then I look at myself, I said, you are anointed of the Holy Spirit. And because you are anointed of the Holy Spirit, you are the head and not the tail. You are the best. Nobody can manage you. You are too good for the world. You are of God. It's a consciousness. You will know it so much and it will look as if you are proud. But many people don't have this consciousness. When they are going out, they are hoping that things will work. They are thinking and praying for it not to fail. How can it fail when you are there? They say you are of God. That means you came from God. The things God does is what he expects you to do. How can you, who is of God, join yourself to a business and it fails? Those days when Bethany the host gives you food to eat, he tells you the food is anointed. When he gives you his cloth, he tells you the cloth is anointed. It's a consciousness. They invited Paul for a meeting, just the way I was invited here, and Paul could not go. And Paul didn't bother. He carried his handkerchief and cleaned his face and gave them the handkerchief. He said, take the handkerchief there. How can a man walk in so much consciousness that he knows that even his own handkerchief is anointed, and the handkerchief was casting out demons? Meanwhile, you are in your shop and you are afraid that demons are attacking you. You are in your house. I'm not talking about your clothes. You are in your house and you are afraid that things will not work. Things will work because you are anointed. It has to be a consciousness. That was how Jesus walked. In Luke chapter 4 verse 18, when Jesus came into the synagogue, before Jesus began to speak, Jesus made a statement. He said, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. I know, I am sensitive to it, that the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. I'm not coming because I've just read a book. I'm not coming because I'm intelligent. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He has anointed me to preach the gospel. He has anointed me." So when Jesus goes to pray for the blind, he knows that there's an anointing upon his life to open blind eyes. When he speaks to the deaf, he knows there is an anointing. How come you go to your business, you don't know there's an anointing? How come when you touch your children, you don't know there is an anointing? The Israeli people, when a child is about to go out in the morning, the child will kneel down before the mother and he will say, "The Lord bless you. The Lord cause his face to shine upon you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you. The Lord give you peace." They know that by touching their children, they are blessing them. They had a consciousness of the anointing. Everything they did by the anointing. When you sing, you should sing with a consciousness. When you talk, you should talk with a consciousness. When you do your business, do it with a consciousness. I know I went to apprenticeship for 7 years, but in addition to it, there's an anointing on my life. I know I was ordained by the bishop, but in addition to it, there's an anointing on my life. I know I'm a public speaker, but in addition to my eloquence, there's an anointing. That anointing is what makes the difference, but that anointing will never be activated until you who carry it become aware. In 1 Samuel chapter 9 verse 19, when Saul went looking for his father's missing asses, they met Samuel, and Samuel looked at them and they said, "They are looking for the seer." And Samuel said, "I am the seer." He wasn't waiting to feel something first. "I am the seer." Today, if you walk in the consciousness of the anointing, people may think you are proud, but that's the key. God is waiting to know whether you know. The moment you show God that you know, the faithfulness of God is activated to bring it to pass. Because what you have done is that you have brought God to the ring. You are not the one fighting anymore. God is the one fighting on your account. But many times we leave God behind and we want to fight. I will never fight without God. When anything confronts me, I bring God on the scene. The moment I bring God on the scene, God will prove himself. I know there is a tumor in your belly. I know they told you about high blood pressure. I know they told you about hepatitis. I know they told you about cancer. But before you respond, tell them, "My body is the temple of the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Ghost dwells in my body. And if the Holy Ghost dwells in my body, cancer cannot kill me. Diabetes cannot kill me. I know I'm not the Lord over this body. There is a spirit that dwells in this body." And he said, "Him that is joined with the Lord is one spirit with him." There is something you carry. It's called the Holy Spirit, and the power of the Holy Spirit is upon your life. The problem is that you are not aware. That's why you are so afraid. You are afraid because you think you are the one fighting. If you knew God was fighting with you, your fear will die. Gehazi was afraid, and Elisha told him, "I am not confident because I'm a prophet. I am confident because we have more on our side." And Gehazi was doubting, and he said, "Lord, open his eyes to see." Elisha doesn't need to see. He already believes. He carries the consciousness. Gehazi's eyes needed to be opened because he was walking in doubt. A man who is walking in faith doesn't need to see to believe. He believes, that's why he sees. There are two different realms. Elisha doesn't need to see a chariot. But even without seeing chariots, Elisha knows that the jealousy of God is his defense. even if a whole army rise up against him, there is an anointing that he carries. That's the consciousness that David had. He said, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou anointed my head with oil. So when David is walking through what kills other men, he's smiling. And you look at him, you say, are you okay? Are you not aware that we are going to perish? No, we don't perish. The Lord is with us. I entered that circumstance with the Holy Spirit. I entered that battle with the Holy Spirit. I entered that relationship with the Holy Spirit. I entered that room with the Holy Spirit. And if I entered with the Holy Spirit, he said, if God be for us, who can be against us? There's a consciousness. That's the secret for activating the anointing. Take for example, church has been built. See how massive church is. And if you are not careful, you are wondering, how will this church be filled? Why will I think how church will be filled? Was I the one who built it? If I didn't build it, why will filling it be a challenge? The same anointing that built it, that anointing will fill it. And then you are asking yourself, what if they bring the dead? What if they bring the blind? What if they bring the deaf? Before they brought the deaf, the building itself was erected by the anointing. The invincible hand that built the building can open deaf ears. It can open blind eyes. It can raise the dead. With that consciousness, you will make war. That's why David said, by my God, I ran through a troop. By my God, I leaped over a wall. There is nothing you bring against him that can move him, because it's not the one fighting. It is God fighting on his behalf. And if you know that God is the one fighting on your behalf, when your enemy throws their best shot, you'll say, try again. Because I came with the lion of the tribe of Judah. I came with the warrior, the Lord of hosts. I came with El Elyon. What you are dealing with is nothing. Hope you know that was how David lived his life, by the anointing. A little boy of 14 years, he saw a bear and he killed it. A little boy of 14 years saw a lion and killed it. And when he met Goliath, that was when he told them his secret. I didn't kill a lion because I'm strong. I killed a lion because there is something on my life. And when he saw Goliath, he said, who is this uncircumcised Philistine that defiled the army of the Lord? He changed the battle arena. Goliath thought he was fighting David. David set Goliath up with God. And he said, you come to me with bows and arrows, but I come to you in the name of the Lord our God. I come to you in the name of the covenant of the God of Israel. Anything that comes against that God will go down, because it's the Lord of all. What is the consciousness you carry? You are afraid because you think you are alone. You are weak because you think you are alone. You think you'll be defeated because you think you are alone. When you know that God is with you, even in the valley of the shadow of death, you will be bold. It's consciousness. It's consciousness. It's consciousness. When I knew this thing, at 200 level, I told my dad, I don't need you to pay my school fees anymore. There is a wisdom here that can create wealth. At 200 level, don't pay my school fees anymore. My dad, you know, the father wants to take responsibility. It's his pride. We kept battling over paying school fees. I'm rounding up my PhD now. I have never asked anybody for a dime. There's something in me that can create wealth. There is something in me that can create change. It's called the anointing of the Holy Spirit. When you know this, the things that throw men down, when they come, you'll be thinking of your testimony. When men are going through crisis, they are hoping not to die. You are thinking of how you will share the testimony. Sometimes when things hit us so hard, I tell my friends, I'm imagining how we share the testimony. They say you have cancer. Why some people have cancer? They are seeing themselves in a coffin. You are seeing yourself dancing in church on Sunday and telling the whole people how the cancer died. You are two different people. One has the consciousness of death. The other one has the consciousness of life. The one that has the consciousness of life will continually prosper. Both of you are in debt. Why somebody else is thinking to run away from town? Because he thinks his end has come. Another person is thinking how he will not only pay the debt, but in this same city, He will give money to people and he will lend money to great people. What is the difference? It's a consciousness. The other one's sufficiency is in himself. The other one's sufficiency is in his God. And the man who is aware that God is with him is a man that can go to hell and come back. Consciousness. You will leave this meeting tonight and you will go home and you will kneel down and thank God and say, thank you, Father, because you have anointed me with your Holy Spirit. And so I have favor. And so I have wisdom. Everything I do prospers. See, there are many young ladies who are afraid. There are many young men who are afraid. Young men are afraid because they think they may not get a job. They think they may die. You don't need a job to survive. You need the wisdom of God to survive. There are many young ladies who are afraid. The moment they become 24, they start having anxiety. When they are 26, they have high BP because they think they will not get married. That's why most of them lose their virginity, because they are under pressure to get married. You don't need to beg any man to marry you. You are the favored vessel of God. You are supposed to make choices because there is something on your life. Even if there are a billion women in that city, you are different. There were many virgins, but there was an ointment that Esther smeared on her body, and the king could not but choose her. You marry by favor, and favor is the anointing. So refuse to fear. Refuse to fear. It brings torment. Just become aware that you carry something. Become aware, and it will change your life forever. How do you activate the anointing? Number one, by consciousness. We are preachers. Sometimes you enter a meeting and everywhere is dry. You do everything you know to do. Everywhere is dry. You sing a worship song, the people are looking at you like this. You preach, they are looking at you like this. You shout, they are looking at you. You pray, they are looking at you. Sometimes you step back and then you tell yourself, I'm anointed. The hand of God is on my life. Things don't happen to me. I make things happen. And the moment you begin to tell yourself who you are and what you carry, the atmosphere will begin to change. And even if it doesn't change, you will puncture the atmosphere. Suddenly your eyes open and you begin to flow in word of knowledge. Suddenly authority comes upon you and you begin to decree, and the Holy Ghost begins to move. The same people that their hearts are locked, when the anointing show up, they have no choice. They have no choice. It's the secret of success. It's the secret of dominion. It's the secret of victory in life. Oh, we're out of time. God, we're out of time. Out of time. I want to pray for you. But in case you want to study, the second way to activate the anointing is to speak faith-filled words only. Never speak fear. You will have what you say. That's how God works. When a man is going through issues, God is waiting to hear what he will say. The children of Israel were moving in the wilderness for years, and God sent out spies to go and check the promised land. When they went there, they came back. 10 said, we are like grasshoppers before them. They saw the same thing, but Joshua and Caleb said, we are well able to take the land and to subdue the people. When those people said they were grasshoppers, Joshua and Caleb tore their garment and began to weep. God, the Bible said, he heard them. And God did not just say they spoke unbelief. He said they had an evil heart because they refused to believe in God. And he said, one day will become 1 year. So a journey that should be for 40 days became a journey of 40 years. And all of them perished in the wilderness. In Job 22:29, he said, when men are cast down, that means men truly are cast down. He said, but what will determine whether you will rise or not is what you say. He said, you will say, I am lifted up. He said, let no one in Zion say, I am sick. The reason is because God will confirm what you say. In Isaiah 44 verse 26, he said, I, the Lord, I confirm the words of my servant and I perform the counsels of my messengers. Can I shock you? Most of you, where you are in life today is an aggregation of the things you have said over the years. Some people are in poverty today because they've talked poverty all their lives. Some people are in sickness today because they've talked sickness all their life. So the power that should change their circumstance, when that power is released, they short circuit it. Because God will only respond to what you say. That's why he said, keep me a remembrance of my word. He said, by thy words thou shalt be justified, and by thy word thou shalt be condemned. You want to see yourself walking in the anointing? Only speak faith-filled words, because your word is more than communication. Your word is the activator of the life and the spirit of God. That's why Jesus said, the words I speak unto you. He didn't say they are Aramaic. They are not Igbo. They are not English. You may think you are speaking Igbo. It's an Igbo man that is hearing Igbo. When a spirit is hearing what you are saying, he's not hearing Igbo. He's hearing either spirit and life, or he's hearing death and condemnation. You can choose to speak life. He said life and death is in the power of the tongue. You will eat the fruit that you choose. Every time a man wants to walk in the anointing, he begins to speak only faith-filled words. And not so long, he will discover that something will begin to rise on his inside. It's called the anointing of the Holy Spirit. Because when a God wants to walk, he begins to talk. And you were created in the image and in the likeness of God. When he came into the earth, he said the earth was void. Darkness was upon the face of the deep. God didn't cry. Many people are crying. Crying will not make the anointing work. God didn't cry. God didn't run. God didn't jump. He said, let there be light. And the Bible said there was light. If you want to see changes, begin to talk the change that you want to see. Your word, you are at the mercy of your word. And the change you are looking for is at the mercy of your word. Because you are a king and a priest. And he said, where the word of the king is, there is power. Who can say unto him, what doest thou? When a king talks fear, he will have fear. But when a king talks victory, whether the enemy likes it or not, he will succeed. In the ancient times, when they want to go to war, the whole soldiers will gather and they will bring an orator. And the orator will charge them with words. When the orator is done talking, the army, even though they are smaller, they will go to that battle and conquer and return. And then you are wondering how. Even the secular world, they know it. They call it morale. Morale. When you talk yourself down, you go down. But when you talk faith-filled words, you activate the anointing of the Holy Spirit. You are not defeated until you say so. You are not dead until you say so. You are not weak until you say so. You are not overcome until you say so. You are not poor until you say so. What you say is what you will have. That's how you walk in the anointing. Number three way to walk in the anointing is to yield to the Holy Spirit. Because this business is beyond just talking. There's a spirit at work in us. The Bible said there's a spirit in man. The inspiration of the Almighty giveth him understanding. You have to learn to yield to the Holy Spirit. And the way to yield to the Holy Spirit is to continuously obey him. Don't only quote scripture and disobey the Holy Spirit. In Ephesians 4:30, it says, grieve not the Holy Spirit that is within you. You grieve the Holy Spirit when you disobey him. In 1 Thessalonians 5:19, it says, quench not the Spirit. You quench the Spirit when you do not do what he says to do. Sometimes you sit down and the Holy Ghost says, stand up, go and start selling pure water. And then you now sit down and say, who succeeds by selling pure water? You have quenched the Holy Spirit. Sometimes you sit down and the Holy Ghost says, make a declaration. And then you are asking yourself, what will it change? Whether I say it or I don't say it, the worst has already happened. You have quenched the Holy Spirit. It doesn't matter if there's a mountain before you. When the Holy Ghost begins to move you, respond. And then you will see the finger of God. Moses was crying to God before the Red Sea. And God said, go forward. How do you go forward when the Red Sea is before you? Am I going to drown? He said, go forward. And the moment Moses stretched his rod, the Bible said, with a blast of his nostril, he parted the Red Sea. God cannot walk until you become yielded to the Holy Spirit. There could be a mountain before you. There could be a sea before you. When the Holy Ghost moves you, respond. That's how you see the finger of God. That's how you see the power of God. That's why you see the glory of God. You cannot walk in the anointing until you become yielded to the Holy Spirit. A generation that will be so full of the anointing will rise. A generation that will know the power of the Holy Spirit by experience will rise. The last way to walk in the anointing is to honor those that carry it. In Hebrews chapter 7, verse 7, he said, without every contradiction, he said, the less is blessed of the better. God said to Moses, I will take of your spirit and I will put it upon 70 elders so that they will be able to bear the burden with you. The spirit that is upon a man and the operation of the Holy Spirit upon a man can be transferred to another when you discern it. That's why I say, give a cup of water to a prophet. You will receive a prophet's reward. It's not about the money. It's about the principle of honor. Because he said, honor the Lord with your substance. When you want to grow in the anointing, you honor those who carry it. And the things that happen with them will begin to happen with you. Some of you, you will begin to honor mama. And the same way something on her life moved somebody to build a church for her, that same thing will now rest on you just by honoring her. And then you will be shocked that shop you are trusting God to be built, somebody will build it for you. And you are saying, what is happening? The operation of God on one man's life has come to another. He said he sent his word to Jacob, he lightened upon Israel. When God is working with one person, he wants to do it for every other person. But he wants the rest to discern it and honor it. Then it will flow in them. Our generation don't know how the anointing works. So when God is working with somebody, instead of celebrating and honoring it, we become bitter and we begin to fight that grace. And the more you fight that grace, the more you will never have it. It was Aaron and Miriam that should have walked in the highest realm of the Moses anointing, but they dishonored Moses. And a little boy called Joshua was the one God raised and put the anointing upon him. And when Moses left, they were elders, but the anointing located Joshua, because Joshua honored the anointing. Never find yourself dishonoring people that the Spirit of God is upon their life. You will set yourself up for destruction. Bow your heads down. Let me pray for you. Elohim Adonai. Elohim Adonai.
Ah, Elohim.
Elohim Adonai.
Ah, Elohim.
Elohim Adonai.
Ah, Elohim.
Elohim Adonai.
Ah,
blessed by the message you just listened to and wish to make Jesus your Lord and personal Savior, kindly repeat this prayer after me. Dear Heavenly Father, I believe in your Son, Jesus Christ, and that he died for my sins and was raised from the dead for my justification. I therefore confess with my mouth that Jesus is the Lord of my life. I receive eternal life into my spirit. I am born again. Thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. If you just said this prayer, please send us an email on amodiscipleship@gmail.com or reach us on our website, orokpomichael.com, to enable us to reach you and afford us the privilege to disciple you. God bless you.
If you are really blessed by this message by Apostle Michael Orokpo, please do us a favor by sharing to your loved one and to your group. Please subscribe. Click on the notification bar for more related videos. Thank you and stay safe.